Hello, welcome all to EC701 RF and Microwave Engineering. In RF and Microwave Engineering course, we are going to learn the circuits for RF and Microwave Engineering. It would include the passive circuits and the active circuits and different applications of RF and Microwave Engineering. I am Shourish Haldar of Electronics and Communication Engineering Department, JIS College of Engineering. So let us start with our basic information on what is microwave, what is RF, and what are the differences between general electronics engineering or electrical engineering and RF and microwave engineering. Now, the electromagnetic spectrum is a very huge range of electromagnetic frequencies. We have learned electromagnetics in our previous semester, and we have understood that electromagnetic waves propagate through different medium by different nature. There can be certain effects. We need an antenna to radiate electromagnetic wave. Now, regarding electromagnetic spectrum, we need to know that spectrum was first referred to the light spectrum, where there are different colors. In the light also, the colors depend on the frequency of the electromagnetic wave that is occurring. So different spectrums can then also be applied to electromagnetic waves in general, not just visible light. Although the term spectrum came from visible light, it was soon applied to electromagnetic waves in general. So electromagnetic spectrum refers to the range of all possible frequencies of electromagnetic radiation, and it extends from very low frequencies to very high frequencies. Now, what are the examples of very low frequency electromagnetic spectrum? Very low frequency electromagnetic spectrum is used in submarine communication, where due to the conducting nature of seawater, the skin depth is low. So seawater essentially acts as a lossy dielectric and hence dissipates electromagnetic frequency faster. So as we understand from the propagation of electromagnetic wave, higher is the conductivity, lower is the depth of penetration. Higher is the frequency, lower is the depth of penetration. Hence, if we have very low frequency, we can go deeper into the higher depth of seawater so that we can access the submarines. Now, in case of very low frequency, it can go to less than 1 hertz or millihertz frequency. In case of high frequency, it can go to 10 to the power 18 hertz per second, or 10 to the power 18 hertz, that is 10 to the power 18 cycles per second, that has already been recorded. So, and gamma radiation, cosmic microwave background radiation, all these radiations has very, very high frequency beyond visible light range. In fact, X-rays has also very high frequency. The wavelength of X-rays is in nanometers. So wavelength of electromagnetic waves can go from thousands of kilometer to the fraction of the size of an atom. Now, what is the range of, see, one circuit or one kind of circuit can never be applicable to all kinds of electromagnetic spectrum, because the antenna size and the device size and the transmission line size all depends on the wavelength of the spectrum. So in case of microwave, the microwave usually refers to that part of the electromagnetic spectrum which is covered from wavelength ranging from 1 meter to 1 centimeter, or in frequency scale of 300 megahertz to 30 gigahertz. Now, the speed of electromagnetic wave is constant in a particular media. So if it is in vacuum, the corresponding wavelength corresponds to 1 meter to 1 centimeter, or 300 megahertz to 30 gigahertz. So above this frequency, the wavelength becomes in the order of millimeter, and it's called millimeter wave communication or millimeter wave circuits or millimeter wave study that goes to 30 gigahertz to 300 gigahertz. And the term microwave essentially stands for extremely small in scale. And it includes both microwave and millimeter wave spectrum, that is UHF, SHF and EHF bands. So UHF starts at 300 megahertz and it goes till 300 gigahertz. So an order of 300 megahertz to 300 gigahertz, we can wholly combine as microwave. So essentially the wavelength goes from 1 meter to 1 millimeter, or a range of 1,000. Now moving on, so we are quite clear that 1 meter wavelength in free space to 1 millimeter wavelength in free space. Moving on, the frequency band goes from electromagnetic general frequency band designation goes from 3 kilohertz to 30 kilohertz, as for general understanding. 3 kilohertz to 30 kilohertz is very low frequency. This is typically used for navigation and sonar. From 30 kilohertz to 300 kilohertz, it is used for radio beacons and navigation. Now, radio beacons, in the sense, there are for navigation purposes and timekeeping purposes, certain radio beacons continuously radiate a frequency which is used for, which is used by different airborne and ship navigation ships to understand that this is the frequency, this is coming from here, and hence so on. So each of them would have their own frequency, unique frequency. 300 kilohertz to 3 megahertz medium frequency is used for AM broadcasting and Coast Guard communication. 3 megahertz to 30 megahertz is used for high frequency for telephone, telegraph, fax, ship, coast-to-coast aircraft. 30 megahertz to 300 megahertz, very high frequency, is used for air traffic control, etc. Now we are already in the RF range. RF means which is handheld, etc. Now 300 megahertz to 3 gigahertz, ultra high frequency. This is used for satellite communication, surveillance radar, mobile communication, television and navigation leads. Now mobile communication has come up hugely in our present scenario. Almost everyone who is listening to this lecture has a mobile phone. The overall number of mobile phones in the world is more than 1 billion. So the study of RF and microwave engineering would help you, or help the participant, greatly in understanding mobile communication. What is the mobile communication? In mobile communication, all the circuits, all the transmitter receiver circuits fall under the purview of radio frequency communication. Now, then on the 3 gigahertz to 30 gigahertz super high frequency communications falls for airborne radar, microwave communication, mobile communication, and satellite communication. Then 30 gigahertz to 300 gigahertz extreme high frequency is for radar. Now radar is an ubiquitous item that has application now in from automobile to range detection to aircraft navigation to ship navigation to missiles to almost huge area is this radar. Then from 300 gigahertz to 6 terahertz, we have terahertz time domain spectroscopy. Spectroscopy is the analysis of what are the components there are in a, what are the constituent materials there are in a simple substance, or spectroscopically in 300 gigahertz to 6 terahertz range, there can be imaging, as in the terahertz imaging system can be kept in airports to understand what is inside a bag or what is inside some opaque material. So that can be done by terahertz imaging. And this is very highly applicable in security purposes. Now 6 terahertz to 100 terahertz is used for guided missile and thermal imaging. Now guided missiles, they use this, this is not exactly simple antenna based communication. 6 terahertz to 100 terahertz is not antenna based communication. It is infrared communication, and they use solid state infrared sensors or solid state infrared imagers for this solution. 100 terahertz to 400 terahertz is near infrared for fiber optic telecommunication, night vision, long distance telecommunication. Now 400 terahertz to 750 terahertz is visible light. This is used for optical communication. 750 terahertz to 1 petahertz is near ultraviolet. The optical sensors, UVID, label tracking, barcode, forensic analysis, all these things, protein analysis, these are used for this near ultraviolet electromagnetic spectrum. There are other applications that goes to etahertz. So gamma rays, these are used for it is greater than 30 etahertz, and gamma rays are not generated. These comes from radioactive substances. This is used for irradiation, gamma knife surgery, nuclear medicine. These are coming from elemental materials. So X-rays or hard X-rays go from 3 etahertz to 30 etahertz. And here the wavelength is near about in nanometers. Now, during World War II, most of the microwave communication development came up. During this, there were terms designated to different bands. The L band, S band, C band, X band, KU, K, KA, Q, U, V, all these bands designated in a secret communications and what would be the frequency range. Now here the frequency range is given as L from 1 to 2, S from 2 to 4, C from 4 to 8, X from 8 to 12, so on and so forth. Now the range of frequencies that we would be most interested in is from L band to X band. the L band range of frequencies, L band and S band range of frequencies is used in handheld and radio communication, and X band is the range of frequencies that are available for experimentation in our laboratories. The other frequency bands, KU, K, KA, Q, these are all applicable, but in our laboratory, we do not have the facility for generating or experimenting with these things. As per US Navy and International Telecommunication Union, they also have LC, X, KU, but they designate the frequency in a different manner, and these are not majorly used. So they have their own frequency designations. In L band, they designate it as 0.390, 1.55, etc. Now, this is essentially, this was done due to mainly wartime security purposes, but the standard has continued on. Now, we come to the characteristic features of microwaves. Now, first we have to understand what is the limitations that we face and why do we have a separate microwave engineering course. Now, up to around a frequency of 1 gigahertz, most circuits can be designed using lumped parameter circuit components. Whatever circuit element that we have seen, banded resistors, capacitors, in some cases inductors, and lot of intermediate frequency transformers, then our transistors, MOSFETs, etc., etc., all these things are lumped circuits. Now, as we move beyond 1 gigahertz or even 500 megahertz, the lines connecting those circuit elements have a comparable frequency, have a comparable length to the wavelength of the frequency of communication. Let's say at 300 megahertz, the wavelength is 1 meter. So at 1 gigahertz, the wavelength would be around 30 centimeter. So 30 centimeter wavelength, and the circuits, if a line is 1/10 of the wavelength long, that is around 3 centimeter long, it becomes a significant radiator. Similarly, if there are open or singular lines connecting the circuit elements, they would become radiators. Similarly, the small, very small capacitances between the leads become significant impedances beyond 1 gigahertz. So all these things becomes a significant contributor to the circuit response. So the KCL and KVL normal voltage current concepts are not applicable. Why? See, we can measure voltage and current through multimeters and oscilloscopes. But the oscilloscopes can only measure, general oscilloscopes that are available in lab can only measure up till 100 megahertz. General voltmeters that can measure AC voltage, it does not show the frequency generally, but the multimeter mainly used for DC measurement. For AC, oscilloscopes are used, but oscilloscopes cannot measure voltages more than 100 megahertz. So the voltage and current measurement theory is not applicable here. Similarly, the KCL and KVL, as soon as we cannot use the current and voltage measurements, KCL and KVL and methods of analysis cannot be used. Now, above 1 gigahertz, the propagation time of the signal becomes comparable with the time period of the signal. And hence, the lumped parameter circuit component length also becomes comparable to the wavelength. Hence, there is a rapid amplitude and phase variation of the signal with distance. So we cannot take the connections as previously we used to take the connections between circuit elements as short circuit. That is, there is no change of voltage along that length of the line, along the connection. But this cannot happen here. So we have to analyze these connections in terms of electromagnetic equations or electromagnetic Maxwell's equations or Hemo's equations. So all the signals are to be considered as electromagnetic wave and propagating as electromagnetic waves. Now above 1 gigahertz, the lumped circuit elements are replaced by distributed circuit elements. So what are distributed circuit elements? Distributed circuit elements are something where the resistor, capacitor, inductor and conductance are measured as per unit length. We have seen this in transmission line sections. So all the microwave circuits can be approximated as transmission line sections, and there are no fixed drop of voltage over a certain length of conductor. Now this model, the connecting wires are not perfect conductors as we discussed just now, right now. So there would be a change of voltage along the length of the connector. Now at high frequencies, the distributed circuit model is more accurate, and lumped circuit model and more complex in nature. So the existence of non-uniform current in branches and non-uniform voltages at the nodes further complicates the analysis of the circuit. So we are going to use calculus than linear algebra. Now, what are the challenges in designing microwave sources? So in low frequency, we generally use oscillators made up of transistors. But the transistors itself, they have a certain restriction, like they have to have a capacitance between their leads, they have their diffusion and depletion capacitances, and there are inductances. So as the frequency increases, the current amplification of the transistor does not have increase. It decreases with frequency. So they have, all the transistors have a unity gain frequency beyond which the current does not increase. The current amplification does not occur. Now at microwave frequencies, the transit time of the carriers is important. That is, an electron would take a finite amount of time to go through the base region of a bipolar junction transistor or the gate region of a MOSFET. This time becomes comparable with the frequency of operation. When this becomes comparable, those transistors cannot be used for generation of oscillation. Now, the number of new principles comes into play for generation of this microwave frequency. So velocity modulation comes into play in our klystron tubes and magnetrons and several other things. Now, interaction of space charge waves with electromagnetic fields, quantum mechanical tunneling for GaN diodes, avalanche breakdown for avalanche diodes, transfer electron techniques, and so on and so forth. Now, quantum mechanical tunneling is generally used for tunnel diodes. So those are essentially negative resistance devices where as voltage increases, current decreases. So for generating microwaves, we are going to use a whole different set of devices. So we need to study those. Now, in case of microwave, we already established that we cannot use our multimeters and oscilloscopes and any such things, because the leads of the oscilloscope, the leads of the multimeter is going to radiate our electromagnetic or microwave signals. That is one thing. Secondly, the multimeters and oscilloscope cannot measure any frequency, measure any signal at a higher than a certain frequency. So all those techniques are done. We cannot measure voltage and current. So what do we do? What do we do is we use certain sensors, field strength sensors. Those sensors measure the electromagnetic radiation along a transmission line. Those are known as field strength meters. Those are known as, it can be also called as current probe or voltage probe. Essentially, those are, they measure the electric field and magnetic field along a transmission line. By those measurement, we can find out the standing wave ratio, that is the highest voltage along the line and the lowest voltage along the line. And we measure the ratio and find out the standing wave ratio. Once we have the standing wave ratio, we can extract several things about a microwave circuit, such as the load impedance, such as the reflection coefficient, such as the power transmitted, all these things. Secondly, we use power meters. The power meters gives us the measurement of the incident power, reflected power, and so on. The incident and reflected powers gives us the how much power we are actually delivering to the load, how much power is getting lost. So all these measurements we get from our power meters. Then we have much more costlier equipment as spectrum analyzer and network analyzers. Now, spectrum analyzer measures all the radiation through a microwave spectrum or electromagnetic spectrum. Secondly, the network analyzer is a beautiful experiment, beautiful setup. A network analyzer has minimum two ports. It gives certain amount of energy at high frequency through one port and measured what is the amount of power it is receiving from the test device through another port. So there are two ports. One port is a transmitter, second port is a receiver. The transmitter port inserts certain power to the circuit and the receiver port measured the received power. The difference between received power and measured power helps us to find out what are the characteristics of the circuit. So we can measure the reflection coefficient, we can measure the transmission coefficient, we can measure the S parameter matrix, we can measure the gain, and so on and so forth. So network analyzer is another important equipment for microwave measurement. Now, again, due to the radiating nature of microwaves, we cannot use general cables and components. They would start radiating and incur huge amount of loss. Hence, we need special cables and connectors with standard impedances. So if there is an impedance mismatch between the components that are used in a microwave circuit, we would not be able to use them. So special cables and connectors are required. The meter impedance and capacitance also affect the measurement. Now, the So, in summary, the microwave measurements are carried out in terms of field amplitudes, phase difference, and power carried by the waves. Now, what are the advantages of microwave? After all these problems, why are we going to use microwave? So the advantages of microwave are we have very high bandwidth of measurement. So what do we understand by high bandwidth? So in the old days, the fixed landline telephones had a bandwidth of 3 kilohertz. And in those days, the speed of internet was 56 kilobits per second. Now we have microwave communication over our mobile telephones, and the bandwidth as of 4G can extend up to 100 megabits per second. So essentially, higher is the frequency, we have higher bandwidth. Now bandwidth depends on how much variation can we do over the frequencies. So if we have a low frequency signal at around 1 kilohertz or 100 kilohertz, the variation that we can do is from 90 kilohertz to 110 kilohertz. But if we have a 1 gigahertz signal, we can easily vary it from we can easily vary it from 990 megahertz to 1.01 megahertz. So there would be no problem in there. So amount of phase variation, amount of amplitude variation, amount of frequency variation that we can do depends on the center frequency of the carrier signal. So as we increase the frequency, we have higher variation in the frequency and we have higher bandwidth. Now we also have directive properties that we can direct the microwave in a certain direction. It does not go away. I mean, it has a very sharp direction of propagation. Unlike the lower frequencies, it does not vary away from the direction of propagation. And antenna size, reduction in antenna size, the antenna size depends on the wavelength of the signal propagation. So if the signal is propagated, so the antenna size depends on the carrier frequency of the signal. So if we have the wavelength of 10 meters, we must have an antenna of at least 2.5 meters. But all the microwave frequency that is operating, it is above 300 megahertz or 1 meter. So the antenna size would be from 250 centimeter to lower. So 250 centimeter antenna is never used. We have very small antennas nowadays for mobile phones, which are essentially using from starting from 900 megahertz. So the antenna size would be much, much smaller than low frequency communication. Now, low power requirement, this is due to that non-radiating or non-dispersal. So at low frequencies, the electromagnetic wave tends to disperse more. They spread away more from the transmitted point. So in the microwave domain, due to directivity of the high directivity of the antenna, the power requirement is much lower. And then we have certain reliability, which is much higher in microwave. And there is transparency property of microwave, that is microwave wave can go through several dielectrics, but it is reflected by metals. If this is a conductor, it would get reflected. Now, what are the disadvantages of microwave? The disadvantage is in the case of line of sight propagation, microwaves cannot go around the curvature of Earth. It cannot go through densely populated areas, it should have, it has to have a near line of sight propagation. Then electromagnetic interference is there. It should not be the microwave communications cannot be interfered. It is highly susceptible to noise. Let us say it is highly susceptible to noise. How and why we would come later. Now, in case of bad weather, the medium is get the nature. See, the electromagnetic wave propagation depends on what is the medium through which it is propagating. So if it is propagating through air, it would have one characteristic. If it is propagating through rain, it would have another characteristic. It would be highly attenuated. Then another disadvantage of microwave is its costly equipments. So all the components of microwave, all the equipments of used in the microwave differs from the low frequency components, and they have to have new kind of equipments which are costly in nature, due to mostly because the fabrication process, specialized material, gold connectors, etc. So they have costly equipments. Now the applications of microwave. The applications of microwave is huge. So first and more foremost application comes to radar, that is radio detection and ranging. Radar is now present in almost all smart cars, speed measuring units, all the aeroplanes and ships, and in some trains also. It is continuously used by the military applications. Now, terrestrial microwave link, transmission of many television channels over one link, satellite communication is exclusively dependent on microwaves. Radio astronomy is exclusively dependent on microwave. Radio astronomy is something where we study the radiation from the stars through microwave antennas. So we have an array of antenna, we have a huge field of antenna from where we study the radio astronomy. Now the linear particle accelerator. The linear particle accelerator is a straight line particle accelerator where we accelerate the particle and they collide and certain materials come out of them. Certain subatomic particles come out of them, and we study those subatomic particles. Now, studies on basic properties of materials. So microwave spectroscopy is used for finding out what are the components, what are the elements in a material. Now, microwave oven is a common household item. Microwave heating is used for metallurgy. And microwave imaging is also used in medical science. So here we end this lecture. Thank you. We continue in the next lecture.